What I'm about to tell you today is something I should have told a long time ago. At first, I believed it was normal. Then, I thought it was my fault. Then I was afraid people would think that I wanted it, that they'd punish me instead of him. After that, I was basically dependent on him. There's no way I could have paid for college on my own. And the job market was pretty terrible once I got out, so I needed him for the rent, too. He really had me over a barrel, that lucky bastard. But not anymore. Not anymore. I don't remember exactly how old I was when this happened. We moved into the new house when I was 6, so... And I went to boarding school when I was 11, so I mean, I had to be somewhere between 6 and 11 years old. I was running away from him. He was yelling and chasing after me. Unfortunately, this was not uncommon in our household. But this time, I hid from him. I ran down the basement stairs. I could hear him behind me as I turned the corner on a dime. Knowing that I couldn't outrun him forever, I ran into the closet underneath the stairs and closed the door. Problem was, there was no way out. I listened, heard no footsteps. I thought maybe he was gone. Maybe he'd run past or just given up. But when I tried to open the door, it wouldn't open. I tried again and again. I pushed as hard as I could. It wouldn't budge. I was trapped. I don't even know for how long. But eventually, I got an idea, a plan for how to escape. In that closet, there was a mini trampoline. It was being stored on its side, leaning against the wall. The closet was in an L shape. The ceiling on the other end slanted down. It was the underside of the stairs. My plan was to use the trampoline as a sort of battering ram to make a hole in that far wall, then pull myself up and out, climb up the stairs, and run to safety. I rolled the trampoline over to the slant very carefully because it was bigger than I was. I was afraid it was going to fall on me. I got right up behind it, lined it up with the ceiling, and I bashed it. I bashed it again, and I bashed it again. I saw this yellow stuff come out of the ceiling. I didn't know what it was, so I stopped. I backed away from it. My abuser must have heard the damage I'd done to his precious ceiling, so he finally opened the door. I could tell by the light from the windows that I'd been in there a long time. When I went in, light was pouring through them, but now it was dim. Where was my mom? That's what I want to know. Where was my mom? And why didn't she stop him? Sometime after that, it was a summer day, I believe, my father had been yelling at me, telling me how awful I was because of my autism every day for years. It felt like he punished me just because he damn well felt like it. There was no rhyme or reason to it, just rash randomness. My blood was boiling. I had had enough. So I hit him. It was a stupid thing to do. I was half his size, and I beat myself up over it for years. But what I did to him was nothing compared to what he did to me. He pushed me to the ground, right there on the living room rug. He knelt on my back, all his weight on my lungs, both knees. His hands were out in front, pinning my wrists and holding himself up. It was really hard to breathe. I could barely get enough air. I looked up at my mom and wheezed, "I can't breathe. I can't breathe." Then Dad looked up at her and said, "He's lying." This was my father, gambling with his only son's life. He is a medical professional, and he knew how dangerous it was to squash his little boy like that. And my mom did nothing to stop him. I thought for sure I was going to die that night. I felt the void, the emptiness coming over me. But I wasn't ready to give up and let it take me. Not yet. I couldn't move my arms or legs, but I could move my head. So I did the only thing I could do to get him to move. I bit him. And that's when my mom intervened. She ran over to me, grabbed my arm, put it right in front of my mouth, and snarled, "You want to bite something? Bite yourself!" My dad was hurting me. My mom was hurting me. And I was the one who got sent to the hospital for 10 days. And I kept thinking it was all my fault because I'd hit him right before. They let me think that for 2 years before they told me what really caused that awful night. Apparently, they had put me on medication without my knowledge or consent. Hid it in my yogurt, I didn't even notice. I had a bad reaction to that medication. That's why I hit my father. That's why I lost control that night. Despite everything that happened, they kept me on medication till I was in college. I ended up hurting a lot of people who hadn't done anything wrong. It was only when I stopped taking it without their knowledge that I could say with certainty that I am not a violent person and I would never hurt anyone on purpose. After that night, we went to see a psychiatrist about twice a year. By we, I mean mostly me. I was kind of forced to go. They'd screwed me up so bad, they didn't even know how to fix it. Every time we went, we'd stop by the Welcome Center. I'd pick up a copy of the OIG, the Official Interstate Guide. I'd look at the coupons for hotel rooms and food. I wanted to run away so fucking bad. I found an old cardboard box that was just big enough for me, cut holes in it for my arms and head, and wore it around the house like a suit of armor. I even wore it in the car on the way to school one day. I just wanted my parents to stop hurting me. I found comfort in television and video games. Sometimes on the weekends, I'd secretly play Pac-Man Arrangement on my GBA. I can't tell you how many times I beat the game. It was an escape from the horror I was facing in real life. And TV, it seemed like a window into the outside world. Certainly a better world than the one around me. At first, it was Ninja Turtles, Teen Titans, and Foster's Home. Then it was Danny Phantom, Fairly Odd Parents, and Batman. After that, it was Drake and Josh, Nez Declassified, Avatar, and eventually, Hannah Montana. I'm going to take a wild guess and say that I was probably coming of age at that point, because I bought whole seasons of that one on iTunes. Back then, they cost like $80. I was obsessed. Anyways, my parents sent me away to boarding school when I was 11. I didn't want to go because I thought I was going to lose that window, that escape, those shows, those video games. Moreover, I was just plain scared of what the road ahead would look like. I didn't know. Turns out, it would be the first time I felt safe in forever. We didn't get to watch TV and play video games every night, but we didn't need it. We were a dorm of 9 guys on a 25-acre campus with another one right next door and 2 more across the stream. There was plenty of trouble to get in and out of, plenty of laughs to be had, and plenty of like-minded individuals to draw me right out of my shell. Was I bullied at times? Hell yeah, my first year especially. That tends to happen in middle school when everyone's bodies are going insane. They do it because they're self-conscious. Just look at the guys who did most of the bullying. One of them was 13 years old and looked like Chucky. Another had parents who were going through a bitter divorce. And the last one, well, I can't remember what his problem was. He wore glasses, had a shrill voice, but then again, so did a lot of us. Was he the one who wet the bed? But anyways, in my second year, I thrived. My first handwritten weekly publication, called The Poster, made a comeback so huge, it brought the whole dorm together better than any team-building exercise ever could have. I was one of only three guys who was invited to partake in a contraband video game that my roommate had snuck in. This was back in the days of DS download play, so only one guy had to sneak the game in, and the three of us could play it with him. We played sports, we went fishing, we went camping. I think I might have set something on fire when we did, but I assure you, nobody was hurt. Except maybe the marshmallow. And speaking of food, we had lots of it. Before that boarding school, the most I usually got to have for breakfast was one Pop-Tart. One. I never had real bacon because my parents didn't eat it. I'd never even heard of Oreo cream pie, pigs in a blanket. Again, my parents would have flipped out. They were health nuts. And fresh deer meat? Oh, forget about it. If they had so much as seen a hunting rifle in their backyard, they would have called the cops on my ass. Unfortunately, all good things must come to an end. While the next boarding school was much less fun and the food was much less plentiful, it was still somewhat safer than my parents' home. Especially when I had to fly back home for a break when I was 17 years old. I told my father that I wanted to see the doctor. He asked why. I told him I had a rash on me. He demanded that I let him see it. He asked once. I said I wanted to let the doctor see it. My doctor. I mean, Dad was a doctor too, but that's still no excuse. You can't force a patient to undergo an exam. And you can't have your own son as a patient. He asked again and again, and he would not stop. It was dark outside. I was tired. So I acquiesced. He took me into his bathroom. He made me get undressed in front of him. He proceeded to examine me. And then he said, "I need to let Mom see it." He did not have my permission to examine me down there. He coerced me. He coerced me. He certainly didn't have my permission to bring Mom into his disgusting charade. I just tried to mentally go somewhere else, because the last place I wanted to be was in that room. Around that time, I became obsessed with a show called Law and Order Special Victims Unit. I didn't know why, didn't know what interested me so much about that show over all others. One of my dorm counselors worried that I was interested in the sexual aspect of it, the vast majority of which was violently non-consensual in nature. That worried me too. I didn't ever want to hurt a lady like that, and I made a conscious effort to make sure that I didn't. I still do. It just happens to be easier now that I know I'm not a ticking time bomb. Now that I've accepted my status as a survivor, I know exactly why I would never put anyone else through that pain. And now that I've accepted my status as a survivor, I've come to realize why I really like that show. It presents an idealized world where the police actually believe survivors, and the abusers are held fully accountable for their actions by the public, if not the courts. I went to college because I wanted to live in the dorm, not with him. I joined a group known as Sarah, a group that promotes suicide, abuse, and rape awareness, S-A-R-A. That's what it stands for. We ran a hotline for survivors in need of help. We raised awareness of the common signs of abuse and how to intervene when it occurs. We worked closely with the Title IX office, which also held its own events, emphasizing the definition and importance of affirmative consent. But every time I got a new room on campus, my abuser would desecrate it by forcing his way in. And every time I had to come home, he would make me weigh myself. The only scale was in his bathroom, and he would not let me eat anywhere except in the kitchen. And every time I came down to the kitchen, chances are he'd make his way down there and start picking some kind of a fight with me. That man used my weight as a weapon against me, and I was having none of it. My mom had Coke with her breakfast in the mornings because she didn't like the taste of coffee. Says it reminded her of when she was pregnant with me. A lot of times, she had LaCroix, too. I started getting the cans out of the recycle bin, taking a can opener to the top, and using them as drinking glasses, so I could have a glass of milk before bed at night without them noticing that any glassware was missing. They'd hired my old babysitter to clean the house, and bless her soul, she was kind enough to sneak me a few snacks that I could store in my room without a fridge. When I was recovering from having my wisdom teeth out, I used an old heating pad to melt a chocolate bar so I could eat it more easily. I repurposed my old playroom as a day room so I wouldn't have to spend as much time in the common areas of the house. To my parents, I called it the lab. To my friends, I called it the lounge. To myself, I called it the bunker. When the government made us all stay at home in 2020, that room was about all I had to protect myself from them. After that, I moved into an apartment. The job market was still struggling, so I had to take a job at a grocery store. My parents continued to pay me about once a month to help with the high cost of living. They claimed it was a gift, but the truth is, it had strings attached. This much was considered a partial income match, but I had to give them copies of my pay stubs to get it. That much was for food, but I had to give them all the receipts, and I could only get food on certain days. And the only way they'd pay me was by check, which I had to come over to their house to get. And once again, I had to weigh myself on that goddamn bathroom scale. A gift does not require proof of income or a record of everything you ate. A gift is not used to control you, to gain full access to your life. But that's exactly what they used it for, and that became abundantly clear in late 2021. I told my mom what my dad did. I'd still blocked out most of the details, so I didn't realize she was involved. At first, she acted like she believed me. I'm shocked, worried, like any rational, reasonable parent would be. But a week later, her tune changed dramatically. She started using words like extortion and false allegations. She threatened that they would stop paying me if I ever said anything about it again. That's when I knew for sure that their money was hush money. Shortly after my 25th birthday, I decided that enough was enough. By this point, I'd been working in IT for a few months at the same hospital my mom used to work at. But I quit that job in favor of a better job, one that I hoped they would never know about. I told them I would not be coming over to visit them anymore, and I told them exactly why. I said that if they wanted to keep helping me out financially, they could use PayPal to do that. But I knew full well that they probably wouldn't, at least not for long. All they've ever wanted to do is own me and control me. If they can't do that, then I am not worth a dime to them. All I've ever wanted them to do is to stop hurting me, to admit that what they did was harmful and wrong, to take responsibility for what they did to me. And on that day, I decided that I would no longer let them have any power over me. I would not let them scrutinize my eating habits. I would not let them use food and money as weapons against me. I would not continue to let them belittle and re-traumatize me. And I would not continue protecting a good reputation that they didn't earn. I turned a page in my life that day, the day I decided to cut them off, the day I decided to live my life by my rules, not theirs, the day I decided to better myself, focus on my mental health, and heal from my trauma. I want to send a message to every child who's watching this. I wish someone had come on TV and said it to me when I was a child. If this is happening to you, this is not normal. It is not your fault, no matter what. But you need to tell your teacher, because that's how you make it stop. And to every parent who has willfully abused a child in such an egregious manner, from the day they're old enough to remember to the day they're old enough to leave, you deserve the death penalty. You are the first person that child ever trusts, and when you abuse them, you are screwing up their sense of right and wrong by making them think it's okay. You are setting the groundwork for a future criminal, and you need to get professional help, both for you and for them. To anyone who may have been impacted by the way my parents raised me, I am incredibly sorry. And to those who stuck with me and put up with me for so long, despite the baggage I was carrying around for all these years, God bless you. God bless you all. Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. Thank you for hearing my truth. And I hope that someone somewhere can learn from it and be helped.